That's no moon, it's a space station, the Death Star. But could we build one in the near future? Even if we could amass the vast quantities of raw materials required, and perhaps more importantly, be able to pay for it, we still run into two problems. How do you power the Death Star? And where does the gravity come from? Rewatching The Force Awakens, though, gave me an idea to solving both those problems in one fell swoop. And then it became obvious. The clue is literally in the name. What if at the heart of the Death Star is a star? Ooh, sorry, I'm getting a call.
Wait, Martin, are you saying that the Death Star could be like a miniaturized Dyson sphere with an artificial star in its core, thereby acting as both the power and gravity source?
Yes, that's exactly right, David Kipping from the Cool Worlds channel.
That's actually not as wild as it seems. Physicists like Freeman Dyson have proposed that advanced civilizations might build giant structures around their star as a way of siphoning off all of the star's energy. Instead of being the size of a small moon, like the Death Star, physicists usually imagine these Dyson spheres to be the size of the Earth's orbit around the Sun. But such a colossus has some physical problems. First off, the Dyson sphere is gravitationally unstable, meaning that even a tiny push on the edge of the Dyson sphere will cause it to plunge and crash into the star. Second, by being a rigid shell, the material of the Dyson sphere itself would be under immense compressive strain from the star. In fact, it would be equivalent to building a tower on the Earth which was 100,000 kilometers high. Martin, I have a bad feeling about this. Is this going to scupper your plans for the Death Star?
Actually, they're not a problem for a few clever reasons, which I'll get onto later. First though, some numbers. According to the Death Star plans...
What have you done with those plans?
The space station measures up at 120 kilometers in diameter, and the reactor core is about a tenth of that. Now, applying Newton's inverse square law of gravity for the strength and then integrating over the entire space station, if we want an average gravitational field of 1g, that reactor core has to be 2 times 10 to the 20 kilograms in mass. That's just 370 times smaller than the mass of our moon. But of course, that's just the average gravity stand just outside of the reactor core, and there would be 31g gravitational fields. And go to the outermost floor and you're talking about a third of a g, the same gravitational strength as on Mars. Given that most humans can only withstand up to 5g and only fighter pilots can withstand continuous 9g's of acceleration, you and I best stay clear of the first 2,000 levels of the Death Star, whereas TIE pilots dare only go down to floor 1,150. But could the Death Star itself even withstand the stresses involved? Well, the gravitational stresses on the materials would be given by this formula. And whilst that does depend on the density of the specific material used, it's usually in the region of about a few gigapascals here. Materials like steel and titanium have compressive strengths which are only a few times less than this, meaning that they would implode in on themselves due to the gravitational forces. So that's not great. There is a way around this though. Future wonder materials, such as graphene, could totally withstand the stresses involved. So problem averted. Well, that's the gravity sorted, but what about the power? As our Death Star's core is an artificial star, we can use power from fusion of hydrogen plasma into helium. We haven't cracked fusion power just yet. At the moment, we tend to put in more energy heating the plasma and trying to confine it than we actually get out from the thermonuclear reactions. Naysayers always claim that fusion is 20 years away, but plasma physicists think that the key to cracking fusion power is by going bigger. And our next big experiment is ITER, which will be a third of the volume of an Olympic swimming pool. Not to brag, but my hypothetical Death Star is a quarter of the volume of Lake Michigan. So how much fusion power would we expect to get out?
If you only knew the power.
Well, our Death Star's reactor core is incredibly dense. It's 1,100 times denser than the core of the Sun and about a tenth of the density of a white dwarf star. For fusion to be occurring, we need temperatures of at least 10 megakelvin. Putting those together, the reaction rate gives us 25 exawatts of power. That's 2 million times the power consumption of human civilization. But at those densities and pressures, not only do we have to worry about the plasma's thermal pressure of 300 trillion atmospheres trying to expand the plasma core, the matter is so tightly packed that the electrons' wave functions would ordinarily overlap one another. Pauli's exclusion principle doesn't like that, and it provides an extra outward force, the electron degeneracy pressure. And that measures up at a whopping 5 quadrillion atmospheres. In order to prevent our Death Star from being swallowed whole from the inside, we need to counteract those outward pressures. But perhaps we can use a trick that actual stars do that we could never use on fusion experiments here on Earth. Use the star's own gravity to keep the plasma in check. Plugging everything in, it turns out whilst we've gone pretty damn big with the Death Star, we've not gone big enough. Gravity can only account for 0.003%. But there may be another solution. What if instead we use magnetic fields in the way that we did for lightsabers? That could be the sort of active confinement system to get around the usual Dyson Sphere collision problems when just using gravity. So let's place a magnetic bottle at the heart of the reactor core, keeping all that plasma at bay using the magnetic pressure. Plugging in the numbers, it turns out we just need a magnetic field of 36 million Tesla. That's a lot of Tesla. But to put that into context, the strongest magnetic field ever created by us on Earth was 45 Tesla. I mean, we're talking in the range of neutron stars and magna stars here. So, to make a Death Star, it turns out we just need to be able to create some of the strongest magnetic fields in the universe. And there you have it. Thank you so much for watching all of this video. Don't forget to check out the companion video to this on the Cool Worlds channel. Hey, David, how did I end up in your screen?
It's a trap. Well, no, not really. But if you want to hear more about how astronomers could use current telescopes to detect an object like the Death Star, then make sure you look out for the link at the end of this video for more.
So do check that one out, and don't forget you can like this video, you can share it around, and you can of course subscribe for more stuff from me. Till next time.